I'm waiting for this power tool in the distance there to go off, but you know what? There it goes. Maybe it'll go on again. Maybe it won't go off. So, just like in this world, waiting to say things when people are receptive to them, maybe people won't be receptive for the most part. Maybe these things have to be said right now, even though there isn't this really good receptivity to it. Sometimes it's important just to speak up and say what needs to be said, no matter what the background noise may be. Everyone wants to know, what's the cure for this? What's the cure for that? Is there a cure for cancer? Is there a cure for mental diseases? Is there a cure for suffering? And ultimately, there is an answer for all that. The cure for all of that is to not be born in the first place. That may seem like a cynical remark. It's not. It's the truth. If you're not born, how can you die? If you're not born into a... if you don't have a body, how can you have cancer? You cannot. Not being born robs suffering of its, of all of its opportunities. So the real goal, what I've always focused on, is how not to be born in the first place here. And the question is, what causes us to be born? Does anyone have the answer to that? A lot of people say they have the answers. They say, well, God makes us be born. We have no control over it. It just happens. Or we say there's a process taking place where the soul has to go through these lessons here. So the soul is some kind of pressure that the soul has to incarnate and identify with the body in order to learn lessons. There's that crowd who says that. So everybody has some notions, vague notions about it. But I tell you, none of those are accurate at all. They're just plausibilities. Fact is that we continue to identify with bodies because we're afraid not to. We continue on with the cycles of existence because we're afraid to choose another idea. We're sort of bullied into it. We bully ourselves. We're the bullies. We're our own worst enemy. We are the bullies. And we can call this self-bullying that we're doing, we can call it God. We can say God is bullying us or pressuring us or demanding of us. It's not true. We are doing that to ourselves. But we disguise that by claiming it's a natural process or that God is doing it or some excuse. Whatever excuse is useful for us that distracts us from realizing we are doing it to ourselves. We're doing all of this to ourselves. How are we doing it to ourselves? Is that some great mystery? No, it's not. Very simple. Because we chose the idea of trying to replace reality with a new reality. We wanted to be the prime creators instead of God being the prime creator. Spirit wanted to be the prime creator. That's where this existence came from. This is where all the dying and death and suffering and misery comes from. It comes from this idea. And if you trace it back, you see it has to come from this idea. You can see very clearly how it all stems from this idea. And we deny that we're the authors of this idea. Because if we knew we were the authors of this, we would be aware of what we are, and we'd realize we have no power or authority to accomplish this. To replace reality with a new reality, we have no capacity to do that. So we have to deny that we're the ones who are authoring this idea. We say, oh no, it's coming from somewhere else, some mysterious source. Coming from God, coming just from nowhere, but not from us. You see? And that's what perpetuates our being born over and over and over, identifying with forms. And the forms dying over and over and getting sick all and over. We don't realize that this is inevitable, that all this takes place. So, owning up to responsibility for all of this is really the key. The key to it all. The key to avoid being born once more, again and again. Continuing on with it. You have to accept responsibility and say, yeah, I chose this idea. Nobody's doing it to me. I'm doing it to myself through this idea. See, spirit chooses ideas and mind presents them. You got to get off the scapegoating of mind. I know this has almost become a religion in itself, is blaming the mind, and I'm telling you for sure that is the worst possible thing to do. Blaming the mind. It's become such a casual thing, slipping into so many teachings. Somehow the mind is the villain. Couldn't be farther from the truth. Mind is completely innocent of any wrong, anything to do with this, because it has to present the idea. That's its role in reality. It presents the ideas that spirit chooses. So mind has no choice but to present it. We keep complaining that mind is presenting it in some, mind is messed up. It's become egotistical or crazy or all false. That is always to avoid responsibility for choosing the idea in the first place. That's a key element of the clarity that's being presented here. Very key element. As long as you're blaming the mind, you will continue to flounder. Is the mind the author of existence? Well, yes and no. Let's make this clear. Mind always is the presenter of ideas. Presents the experience of an idea to spirit. But mind is never the chooser of which idea to present. And since the trouble that we're experiencing as spirit comes from just this one particular idea that we are choosing, we cannot give authorship to our misery, the responsibility for that, on the shoulders of mind. Cannot be. It is this idea that's causing the misery, and we are the choosers of that idea, not mind. So it's our responsibility, our fault. We're to blame. We're doing it to ourselves. Choose a new idea and you'll see mind functioning flawlessly and perfectly, and you'll say, oh mind, you're absolutely a complete creative genius, so wonderful. And you'll realize that mind was never ever to blame. It was functioning perfectly well. As a matter of fact, everything is functioning perfectly well. Spirit is functioning perfectly well. Idea functioning perfectly well. Mind functioning perfectly well. God the Prime Creator functioning perfectly well. Reality seamless. Everything is absolutely flawless, always. But it's this idea that we chose. It's not a good idea for us to choose. It's a bad idea, so to speak. It was our choosing this idea that is causing us to feel everything's out of whack. Mind doesn't choose ideas. We chose the idea. Spirit, we chose the idea. Therefore, we have to choose a new idea. Mind can't do that for us. So we keep berating mind and vilifying mind, thinking that somehow mind is to blame and mind has to choose a new idea. What is that? Escaping, avoiding responsibility. Same old song. We can blame God, saying God has forced us to experience all this. Not true. Mind is forcing us to experience this. Not true. The compelling factor is our choosing the idea. That's an act of will on our part. And therefore, the cure is another act of will, saying, I will choose a new idea. So many of the prevailing teachings of the day really are going down the wrong road, because they're telling you that you can train mind to be a more faithful servant. That is such a false teaching. Mind is a perfect servant already. Always will be a perfect servant. You don't have to train the mind to do anything for you. It's functioning flawlessly right now. So all that time that you spend trying to train mind is wasted. Just delaying. There's no real benefit from that at all. Mind is not the problem. It is spirits choosing an idea. It's the idea itself is the problem. This one particular idea happens to be an idea that can't really be experienced. It's kind of like the idea of what would it be like if an idea wasn't an idea? What would it be like if reality wasn't real? What would it be like if functionality didn't function? It's like that. What kind of idea is that? It's obviously, that's a idea of futility. It's a foolish idea, and yet it's still an idea. Like, what would it be like? I have an idea of let's replace reality and wipe it out, get rid of it, and we'll make a new one. How would that work? It's a very foolish, silly idea, and yet it's kind of tempting in a certain way. In a whimsical way, there's some kind of attraction to this idea because it's just so completely stupid and silly. It's kind of like spirit went into a silly season, you know, just felt like, I want to be really silly and see what that's like. And now spirit's crying buckets of tears and crying, oh, mind has abandoned me. Mind is not working right. Mind is trying to be the master of me and not the slave or servant. Mind has gone crazy. I have to fix the mind. And blah, 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 on and on and on. Spirit has got a bellyache, you know, blaming mind. Someday you'll have a laugh at that. Look at this incredible scenario that mind has cooked up for us. Just so that we could continue to be silly. Because that's what we asked for. We wanted to be really, really stupid and silly. And so mind has presented this incredible scenario where we can appear to be completely insane. So mind is doing its job. And spirit, we're continuing to choose this idea because we're afraid to do otherwise. We're afraid we've lost it. We've lost control of reality. Reality's been dissipated, destroyed. We're afraid that we've been successful, that mind has somehow wiped out reality for us. That's why we're worried to say, well, wow, mind, what can you do for us now? I guess you need to make this universe like a perfect place for us because you've wiped out reality for us. So we got no choice but to try and figure out clever ways to manipulate the matter and energy and to make us a suitable home for us. And mind just kind of like scratches its head and says, oh boy, what can I do? Doesn't spirit realize this is all an illusion? It's all a mirage? Nothing mind can do about it. Mind says, okay, I gotta keep trying to present things. Let's present all these solutions and remedies and cures, etc. But there's a little voice speaking to spirit saying, hey, spirit, hey, remember, you chose all this idea. All this is just an alignment with the idea that you chose. None of it is actual as far as destroying reality. None of that is actual. Just a dream you're having. You don't need mind to do anything in the dream. You need to choose another idea. Of course mind is going to continue to present remedies and solutions within this dream, because that's all it can do with this idea. Mind can't do anything other than that with this idea. It has to pretend to spirit there's a way to make it all right and keep coming up with all these interesting progressions, scientific progressions, technological progressions, social progressions, spiritual progressions, telling everybody we can learn to love, everybody can learn to love one another, and then that will make existence a wonderful, suitable home for us. And of course, spirit realizes something's not quite right with this scenario, and it doesn't quite fit. And then mind says to spirit, don't worry, spirit, I'll get you a new sports car, you know. And you know, wow, that engine sounds great. Doesn't be great driving that new sports car. And Sarah says, okay, that maybe that'll make me feel a little better. Mind has to string spirit along, has no choice to do that. It cannot choose a new idea. It has to work with the idea that it is given. That's all that mind is doing. Forget about blaming anything in existence. It's useless. Existence has to be the way that it is. It has to be full of false hope, false teachings, false directions, misdirections, dead ends, wandering around aimlessly in circles. All of that is all part of it. Has to be part of it. As we say, the good, the bad, and the ugly, it's all there. Can never be anything other than that. We'll continue to go round and round and round in circles. The idea that we chose can never be anything other than that. And one day, Spirit will realize that and say, oh, it's the idea that was the bad. Nothing else was wrong. Just this one idea was a crazy idea. That's all. And then that's it. Spirit will say, okay, that's it. I'm ready to move on now because I see it all. It was just the idea. It wasn't the mind. It wasn't the spirit, mind, or ideas in general. It was just this one tiny particular idea that was silly, that was crazy, that was foolish for spirit to choose that. It wasn't wrong for spirit to choose it. Not wrong. It's just that it was foolish and led to believing that reality was no longer viable. So spirit was scaring itself, bullying itself that way. It's like spirit says to mind, you have to bully me. I want you to bully me and terrorize me and be a tyrant and deceive me and kill me and do all these horrible things to me. And mind says, you're the boss. Whatever you want. And then when spirit gets this, it says, ah, stop, I don't like it. But of course, mind has to continue on with this idea. And spirit says, well, maybe mind one day will get tired. It'll finally give up. It'll quit. It'll change its mind. It'll stop doing all this terrible things to me. But consider, if mind did stop, did quit, did give up, how can spirit ever trust mind again with other ideas? So let's say spirit chose a different idea. Let's say spirit says, I want to choose the idea of not trying to get rid of anything. Not trying to get rid of reality. And then spirit would say, well, wait a minute. Mind, I know mind's a quitter. It gives up. It changes. It can't be trusted to deliver the effects of this idea properly. So I'm too afraid to choose that. I better just stick with what I know. You see how that would backfire? Spirit keeps pursuing remedies that actually would backfire. Fortunately, these remedies can never take place. So be glad that spirit cannot, so that be glad that mind cannot give up, cannot default, cannot change what it's doing. Be glad of that fact, because that is actually your ticket out of this idea. Be glad for the misery and the suffering and the hellishness of existence, actually. That's actually your ticket out of it. Because you can trust mind now. You can say, mind, I can see that you were absolutely faithful to this horrible idea that I gave you. And you never deviated from it. And you didn't give up. You didn't change anything. You continue to function flawlessly in this horrible idea. Therefore, I can now trust you with another idea. So here's another idea, mind. And then, boom, you're out of it. You've been saved. So, paradoxically, your salvation really comes from observing existence and seeing that, yeah, it really is terrible. It really is horrible. Mind is doing a perfect job at presenting this ghastly scenario. And mine doesn't stop doing it. Mine is faithful to this. It doesn't change its purpose. It continues on and on and on and on. And eventually you become convinced, say, wow, what a faithful servant mind is to this idea. And then you say, okay, mind, I really trust you that you're going to be faithful to the next idea I give you. You see how that paradox works in your favor. On the other hand, if you keep thinking that somehow mind can be changed, that you can somehow make it quit this idea, then you're really trapping yourself here. Because there's no way then that you can go on to another idea. You would never trust it. So it's a great paradox. Those who are trying to spiritualize existence and trying to get mind to make it all nice for them, they're literally entrapping themselves more and more in this idea, fixating themselves, making it stronger, the fixation stronger and stronger and stronger, because they're losing faith in mind, more and more and more losing faith. Therefore, they would be very, very scared and unwilling to choose a new idea, because they say, well, mind will not present it to me faithfully, because I know I've got mind to quit on this idea, so I know it can quit on another idea. That's the great danger of taking a false spiritual path. They actually make things worse for you. I've said before in previous videos, God cannot intervene in this world, cannot change the way things are. If God intervened, you would never trust reality again. Never. For good reason. And also, if mind could quit on this idea, quit presenting it the way that it must present it, then you would lose all faith in mind. You would say, I cannot trust you, mind, with any other idea, so I have to just stick with what I have. I cannot move on from this at all. So, the real spiritual path is to see this, to recognize that mind is presenting the idea, this crazy idea, correctly. The dance of existence is the way that it must be, and it is terrible. It is based on destructivity. The universe is fundamentally destructive. Its purpose is destructive. And you can see that. Don't be scared to see that. That is literally your salvation. Because you will say, aha, mind is doing exactly what it needs to do. It's functioning perfectly. You'll see that. And then deep in your heart, you say, aha, that's great. That is really great. Thank you, mind. You're very trustworthy. Now I can choose another idea, and I know you'll be equally trustworthy with that other idea, you see? So that is why don't ever listen to those who claim that negativity or fear-mongering or those things, oh, how terrible those things are, awful, you know. Just the opposite. Those things really wake you up. That's what really brings you towards salvation, is seeing the world the way it really is, seeing how it truly functions, seeing that it's all a trap, it's all deception, it's all based on dying, it's based on sacrifice. The universe is a sacrificial machine, that is a fact. It's based on destructivity. Remember, nothing can be destroyed unless something is first constructed. So all this constructivity you see, fine, that's just cannon fodder for destructivity. But instead of getting depressed about this and saying, oh, that's so non-spiritual, it's not. Paradoxically, it's the most spiritual realization there is. It's seeing the destructivity, the nature of existence is inherently destructive. That's the highest realization. Because then you can say, wow, mind, you've been completely faithful to the idea that I gave you. The idea of wanting to wipe out reality and replace it with a new one. You've done a perfect job. Thank you so much. Now I really trust you with a new idea. I know you'll carry that out trustworthy as well. So, it may seem what I'm saying is shocking, you know, and the knee-jerk reaction is to say, oh, that's not spiritual. But the fact of the matter is, it's the highest spiritual teaching. It's the very best. And if you can even catch a sense of this, then you for sure know that you're on track, really on track. You're not a bad person. If you see existence as inherently bad, you're not a bad person for seeing that. You're not bad for seeing that. You're blessed for seeing that. if you really see existence like, wow, this is really destructive, this is really awful, rejoice, because you're blessed to see that. You're just a short step away from connecting the dots. And that's why I'm urging you to listen to this. Connect those dots. If you can just see the logic behind this, right? If mind is faithful to the idea you gave it, then it's going to be faithful to the next idea you give it. If mind is unfaithful to the idea you give it, you're not going to trust that it'll be faithful to the next idea. You're going to believe it's going to be unfaithful to that idea. So if you look at this universe and you see it's all love and light, then you are literally believing that mind has been unfaithful to the idea that you gave it. But if you look at the universe and see it's all destructivity, really, that's its purpose, then you realize that mind is being faithful to the idea that you gave it. And therefore you can trust it to be faithful to the next idea. And the next idea you choose, it won't be a destructive idea. It'll be the idea of not trying to destroy reality, not trying to replace reality. And therefore it will be an incredibly seamlessly peaceful idea and experiencing. Incredibly wonderful feeling that we don't have in this existence. It's called peace beyond understanding. The great peace, the great bliss, the great endless seamlessness of perfect non-destructivity, so to speak, yeah. And all you have to do is connect a few dots. I've been able to do that. I know, so I know you can do it. The dots are right there on the page. All you have to do is draw a line between them and realize that, whoa, it's kind of opposite of what we've been taught. And those of you who've been getting close to seeing this, you realize now, wait, I really am on track. I wasn't crazy. I wasn't wrong. I wasn't misleading people. I wasn't fear-mongering. I wasn't being negative. I wasn't lowering the vibrations of the planet. None of that is true. You are actually getting very close to true salvation, true liberation, true enlightenment, true peace, true love, all of that. Getting very close to it. Why? Because you were getting close to seeing that mind has truly been faithful to the idea that you gave it. That's a wonderful, wonderful realization. So don't hate the destructivity in that way. Of course, we don't like it. No, we don't like it. But see the greater picture. Say, aha. That's just mind being faithful to the idea that I gave it. How wonderful. Now I can choose a new idea and mind will be faithful to that idea. Great. That's the vision. That's the hope that you can catch. That's the breeze that you can fill your sails with at this time, at any time in existence, but this time very much so. That wind is there for you. So let it fill your sails and let it take you to the true paradise, which is choosing a new idea. And then you will feel nothing but paradise for sure. Because you will no longer feel the bite of destructivity. So if you're depressed and despondent and saying, oh, there's so, all these terrible things are going to happen. I can see them all coming. Destructivity, how awful. You know what? You're right on the brink of salvation. That's a fact. So don't let that depression get too great for you. Turn it around. And instead of being depressed, say, wow, I'm really a tremendously clear being to be able to see this. And I'm really right on the brink of freedom. You're getting the call just as I am getting the call. Okay, thank you very much. That's great. That's it. I'll answer the call now.